The American Academy of Pediatrics, the World Health Organization, and other well-known pediatric organizations have proposed many recommendations for the prevention of iron deficiency anemia, which is the most common nutritional deficiency in the world. These recommendations include enrichment of foods with iron, giving iron-rich formulas when breast milk is insufficient, avoiding cow's milk in the first year of life, giving infants iron prophylaxis, and screening infants in the first 9 to 12 months of life for this anemia to see if supplementation is indicated, and preventing premature delivery, because remember, these infants are building up their stores from their mother in utero, and when they're born too soon, their stores are not adequate. The main principles in the treatment of iron deficiency anemia include making the diagnosis, investigating, and eliminating the condition. So how do we replace the iron? Well, we can do this in a few ways. The first is through foods. Non-heme iron is found in plant-based foods such as nuts, fruits, and vegetables. Foods with non-heme iron are still an important part of a nutritious, well-balanced diet, but the iron contained in these foods will not be absorbed completely. You only absorb between 2 and 10% of the non-heme iron that you consume. Another option is heme iron, and that's found in meats and meat products, and the absorption is higher. You can also replace iron orally, and this is through ferrous sulfate. It has high bioavailability. The problem is it can cause GI upset. It can also cause constipation, nausea, and vomiting. And I always tell my patients that if they get a really upset stomach when they're taking their iron supplement, sometimes they just stop taking it, and we can come up with other options to augment their iron intake. In addition, it can cause black discoloration of the stool, so I'm always careful to warn my patients of this. You want to take this 1 hour before or 2 hours after meals, and this is a problem because it's better tolerated if you take it with food, but it decreases the absorption. And you always want to remind patients that vitamin C is going to increase their absorption, so maybe they take it with a little bit of orange juice. Parenteral options are also there. You can do intramuscular or IV infusions, and these are usually in settings of malabsorption, like celiac or inflammatory bowel disease, where orals are not an option. What are complications? Well, patients can have impaired physical growth and compromised cognitive development. Some patients will also develop impaired learning capacity. There's reduced muscle function because of the decreased oxygen to the tissues. There's also decreased physical activity and a lower work productivity. The patient's going to have a lower immunity and an increased risk for infectious disease.